This is Josiah Plays Alpha Protocol. Welcome to my playthrough of Alpha Protocol. This has been a long time coming. Alpha Protocol is one of my favorite games of all time. It is, in fact, my second favorite game of all time after Planescape Torment. I love this game. When I first played it, I immediately played through it start to finish 3 times in a row, which I've never actually done with any other game at the time. And this game gets a lot of hate. It didn't do well commercially, it kind of flopped, which I think is largely the fault of the publisher Sega, personally, but Obsidian, I think, did a great job on it. They tried something new. This is an experimental type of game. There's no other game like it. This is a modern-day espionage RPG. There simply aren't any other games like this. There are other games in this genre of espionage, not many, but there are some, but they aren't RPGs. They aren't even close to RPGs. And there are other RPGs that are similar mechanically to this game, with the dialogues and the skill trees and the, you know, equipment and all that stuff, but those games are not set in a modern-day espionage-type setting. This doesn't have any cyberware, it's not Deus Ex, it's not cyberpunk, it's not sci-fi, it doesn't have any magic powers or psychic powers or anything else, there's no fantasy-type elements to it. It is a pseudo-realistic game. I mean, it's not completely realistic because you do get some abilities as your character goes along that are questionably realistic, but I think they're intended to represent in an abstract sort of way things that you could do maybe in real life if you had all of the possibilities of real life versus what's coded into a computer game. So I think they're abstractions of pseudo-realistic things. One thing that is misunderstood about this game is that it is an RPG, it's not a shooter, even though it has shooting in it. So a lot of people tried to play this game and they thought it was just going to be like a third-person action shooter, and they were very disappointed by how the game played. Because it's an RPG and your success in shooting people is based on your stats, it's based on your RPG mechanics. It's based on your character's skills and how good they are at using that type of gun. So you can shoot right at somebody and you can miss if you're really bad with that kind of gun. And people are like, what the fuck? Why am I missing if I'm actually aiming properly? Because the proper aim is only half of the picture in this game. You've actually got to level up your character's skills to be good with guns. And when you do level up a lot in a certain gun, you become incredibly deadly with that gun. But it requires some player skill, as you do actually have to aim, but it also requires that your character be skilled in what you're trying to do. And I think the game rewards a stealth focus much more so than an outright run-and-gun focus. The first time I played through this, I went for a pure stealth, pure non-lethal, pure hand-to-hand playthrough. I didn't use any guns, I didn't kill anyone, and I was as stealthy as possible. And that was really fun. And what I like about this game is it gives you an enormous amount of choices. It gives you narrative decisions throughout the whole thing to a degree that I have not seen in very many other games ever. Not only do you get to make tons of dialogue decisions that radically alter the way the dialogues play out, but you get to make decisions that radically alter the way the storyline plays out. I mean, the final boss of the game isn't even the same person, necessarily, depending on your decisions. You could be fighting a completely different final boss, as well as the different factions and people that exist within this game. There's so many of them, and you develop like all these dossiers of all these different people and organizations. And what's really cool about this, with the amount of decision making you can have, is by the end of the game, everyone could still be alive. You could literally let everyone live, save everyone's life, not have any major characters die at all, or by the end of the game, everyone could be dead based on your decisions. So, and that changes the way things play out. It changes the way missions play out. It changes what factions you're going to be allied with or enemies with, which different people are going to be your handlers, which different people are going to be your enemies. And so I played through this 3 times in a row when I first got the game, and all 3 times were different. I saw completely different aspects of the story that I had seen from the other 2 playthroughs. So my first playthrough was the non-lethal one, where I saved everybody and all I used was hand-to-hand, and I didn't shoot anybody or anything. Second playthrough, I decided to do the absolute opposite and just go in with an assault rifle and be guns blazing, no stealth, murder everybody. And that was actually much more difficult, because the game does reward a stealthy playstyle more than a guns blazing playstyle. And then my 3rd playthrough, I decided to use pistols, which I had heard were overpowered, and oh my god, they're so overpowered. You become the ultimate killing machine with fucking sneaking around with a silenced pistol in this game. It's amazing. This game has the most satisfying sneaking around capping people with a silenced pistol gameplay of any game I've ever played. I mean, that's a pretty specific sub-branch of gameplay, but it is one that is relevant to my interests. Hello, Saito, welcome. How you doing? Hello, Boss Pie. Thanks for the bits. I appreciate that. So, my 2nd favorite game. I love it so much. It's not a long game, so there's not a lot of extra junk to do. There's not a lot of exploration. There's not a lot of extra random little side quests that are meaningless. It's pretty tightly focused on its story. So you can get through this game pretty quickly. There's not a lot of room to faff about doing nothing for hours at a time like in an open world game. So that means I can get through the game relatively quickly, even playing at the fabled Josiah speed. Well, it was more like the first time I was James Bond, the 2nd time I was like Jack Bauer, and the 3rd time Jason Bourne. The Jack Bauer approach, plus there's like 3 different approaches you can take, generally speaking, in conversations. And this also affects the way things develop, because all of the conversations take place in dialogue cutscenes, just like in Mass Effect. In fact, that's really what I would compare this game to. It's Mass Effect in a modern-day espionage instead of sci-fi. That's what the game feels like and plays like. And wholly different things can happen in those cutscenes depending on what attitudes you take. It's not always just verbal. You know, if you choose the aggressive options, your character can get physical with people, can start beating them up, slamming them around, all kinds of interesting stuff depending on what you choose for your character's demeanor. So you can kind of do a suave approach, a professional approach, or an aggressive approach. And those are generally lined up with James Bond, Jack Bauer, or Jason Bourne, the 3 JBs of this genre of fiction that are all famous characters that we all love. I don't know what I want to do this time. I'm thinking I'll probably go more of a James Bond stealth-based approach, but not entirely non-lethal. I think I'll use a silenced pistol and martial arts. Some people I'll just knock out, some people I'll kill. I'll kind of do a half and half type thing, which I've never done before. I pretty much always just went pure lethal or pure non-lethal before. What is up, Abyssal Zombie? How you doing? Good to see ya. Going Rambo and killing everyone. I am gonna play this on the hardest difficulty, so let me go ahead and jump into it now. I'm playing on the hardest difficulty. Makes it a little more satisfying. Now, there are mini-games in this game, which can be pretty annoying, which get really hard on the hard difficulty, because the hard difficulty doesn't just include the combat, it includes the mini-games, the hacking, the lockpicking, the bypassing alarms and electronics and all that stuff, and those get really difficult unless you get your skills, your character's skills, up in the right area to counterbalance that difficulty. You know, I didn't experience many bugs with this. Of course, I got it late. I didn't get it at launch. I got it later, after it had already had a patch. So maybe that got rid of most of the bugs for me. I don't know. But I didn't really experience much in the way of bugs with this game. I hear a lot of other people saying that there's a lot of bugs in this game. Anyway, this is where you decide what you want your agent to be like. You're always playing the same character, Mike Thornton, like, you know, just like you're always playing Shepard in Mass Effect. You don't get to choose gender, though. You're just one specific guy, but you choose how you spec your guy out. So you can be a soldier, decorated for service in the armed forces. Your commanding officer felt that general infantry was a waste of your potential. Your natural language, talent, and quick wit caught the attention of a recruiter for an agency that doesn't officially exist. You can be a field agent. This is the overpowered one right here. No stranger to covert operations, you've spent the last several years working for the U.S. State Department on overseas assignments. Capable of being a charismatic presence one moment, and an inconspicuous shadow the next, you're always the agent on location, never the one hiding behind a desk. Stealth is the most powerful skill in this game. No doubt. You can actually modify your appearance once you get into the game. Shortly after the start of the game, you get a chance to customize your appearance. BioWare was doing an Aliens game, but game... Yeah, I heard about that. I did hear about that. You can be a tech specialist. Having made a mockery of every aptitude test sent your way, it was no surprise that you finished your first PhD before you were legally allowed to buy alcohol. While the CIA initially hired you to design cutting-edge electronics, being cloistered in a lab proved unsatisfying, and your superiors granted you a transfer to clandestine services. When your handler was asked to recommend an agent for a top-secret assignment, your remarkable fieldwork and your natural grasp of technology made you the obvious choice. There is another way you can play the game, which is heavily based on gadgets. That's really not my thing. I'm not into gadgets, so I never really play a real gadget-focused character. Or you can be a freelancer. Fearless from birth, the only thought that ever caused you an ounce of panic was the thought of a 9-to-5 job. After a remarkable college career, you vanished off the radar of the known world to make your fortune. According to your dossier, you've been a mercenary in Africa, a bodyguard to the Sultan of Brunei, the on-again-off-again paramour of a European princess, and the holder of 3 patents in Great Britain. While the truth is somewhere in the middle, one thing that is clear, your skills caught the attention of some very important people in the espionage world. I don't know that tech is the worst. Tech could actually be fine. I've never really put much thought or focus into tech. I should also make clear, these are not classes. When you choose one of these, it brings up your skill page with some predefined skills. But you're actually able to change these things. Like if I wanted to, I want a toughness, but I don't want a toughness. Instead, I want some sabotage. And you can customize this. So in actuality, all these are is pre-built packages for you if you don't know what to do with your starting skill points and you want to go into a certain theme. And the freelancer is one that just lets you assign everything as you wish. You just start with 31 points and you put them wherever you want. I'm not sure, I don't remember exactly, but I do think these affect dialogue choices once in a while. Every once in a while you'll get a little bit different of a dialogue if you pick one of these, but for the most part they don't do much. Then there's the recruit option. I did this on my second playthrough and it was very hard. The recruit option lets you start with a lot less skills than everyone else, if you want to play like for a super challenge or whatever. And the thing about the recruit option is you have to play through the game once on the recruit option in order to unlock the veteran option. So I did play through my second playthrough on recruit and it made things harder. It says, though you've barely logged 3 months working for the Department of Justice, your ambition, drive, and aptitude caught the eye of a clandestine government agency. Your path will be difficult. With little experience and formal training, you'll have to rely on your wits while you learn your lessons in the field. And if you choose this, you start with no skills whatsoever. You're just an absolute chump, which makes things pretty difficult. You found the Aliens Bioware RPG. Can I post a link? Yeah, you can post a link. Sure. I never knew that they were gonna make a Jade Empire 2. And then there's Veteran, which you unlock by playing through the game once on Recruit. You were the Leonardo da Vinci of clandestine warfare, a gifted marksman, a master of stealth, and a tech-savvy engineer rolled into one. Alpha Protocol didn't go looking for you, you went looking for them. Having saved the world once, why not save it again? I like Veteran. You start with 3 in everything, but then you can still modify this. So, like, I don't care about submachine guns. I'm not going to use submachine guns. I'm not going to use shotguns. Oops. I'm not going to use... No, get back here. I'm not going to use shotguns. Yeah, BioWare and Obsidian, two different companies. This was made by Obsidian. I'm not going to use assault rifles or shotguns. Get out of here, assault rifles and shotguns. So now, these other trees are ones I'm actually going to use. Stealth is the most powerful one. You get various passive things as you put points into these, as well as simply improving your overall ability with the thing. So the more points you have in pistols, the more accurate your shots with pistols are going to be, in addition to all the special abilities and stuff you get. I picked Veteran, the cheater one. Well, it's not really cheater, you have to earn it by completing the game on Recruit mode. So, I'm the cheater guy who gets more points than everyone else. I find that playing Veteran, but also playing on the hardest difficulty, gives a nice blend of challenge, but also capability for your character right out the gate. Otherwise, the first part of the game is a little bit lame because you don't know how to do anything, and your character sucks at everything, and you're trying to just build up your basic capabilities. So, stealth is great. You get some overpowered ass shit, like Shadow Operative is where it starts getting ridiculous. That's where you can pretty much straight up turn invisible for a few seconds. But right now I can't go higher than 5 in any of these, so we're gonna max out stealth. And you get, you know, all these different things. Better critical hit for the pistol, chain shot, which is overpowered. Carry extra pistol ammunition. Lining up a critical hit while in cover. This is what makes... You'll see. You'll see once I start playing. Pistols are beautiful. Stealth. Pistols. But you really don't start getting amazing at these things until you start getting up higher into the ranks. I'm not going to use any submachine guns, shotguns, or assault rifles because really, why? Just why? Sabotage. This is a really important skill. This is basically like your thievery from D&D. This is all of your bypassing locks and bypassing electronics and hacking things and disarming things. It's really important. If you don't, the higher up you go in the sabotage tree, the easier all the mini games are. And I'm telling you right now, if you play on hard and you do not put points into sabotage, the mini games get impossible. Impossible. And that's by design. There are ways that exist with gadgets and stuff which are limited to bypass the mini games entirely. So either you use the gadgets to bypass the mini games, or you don't complete the mini games at all because a lot of them are optional, or you fucking put points in sabotage, or else you're just not going to be able to do them because they get ridiculously hard. Is there a whisper loudly through gritted teeth option? Otherwise, I call bullshit on them calling a style Jack Bauer. I don't know. Some of the stuff that your character does in the cutscenes when you pick aggressive mode are pretty Jack Bauer-like. I mean, we're not just talking about whispering threatening. We're talking about grabbing people, slamming their heads through windows, fucking sticking guns in people's mouths and shit. I mean, like, you get pretty brutal when you pick the aggressive option all the time. Alright, sabotage is really good. Reduces the difficulty of lockpicking, electronic bypass, and hacking attempts. Very important. Alright, technical aptitude helps you with gadgets and stuff, like first aid kits and other little modifications to your guns and things like that. It's alright, but it's not that important. You could easily play through the game without putting anything into technical aptitude. Toughness again, you also really don't need toughness unless you're going for a pure run and gun, no stealth playstyle. Martial arts is optional. You don't really have to use martial arts. You could just shoot everyone, but it's really quite handy. And it's fun as well. I like using martial arts. And this is a sort of another thing, like with sabotage, is the difficulty of the opponent's melee skills increases and increases as you go through the game. So if you don't keep up on raising your martial arts skill, it gets to the point where you just can't melee anyone. They'll just block every single attack you make, and they'll beat your ass. So if you want to melee people, you've got to keep putting stuff into martial arts throughout the game. Oh, let's get rid of some toughness. Because I want to go all in on martial arts here. Alright, there we go. I got all the martial arts, technical, sabotage, pistols, and stealth. A tiny bit of toughness just gives you some extra hit points. Which again, if you're playing properly, in my style, you shouldn't need hit points that often. Except in boss fights and stuff. Some of the boss fights are a little bit ridic. Jack Bauer is basically... Yeah, I love Jack Bauer. 24 is one of my favorite shows. Yeah, the X leftover point is saved, yes. I mean, I could just throw it into something, but I'm not going to, because I'm not going to use these at all. So basically, the nice thing about Veteran is I start off maxed out in all the skills I care about. Well, maxed out for starting. Obviously, as you can see, there's a lot more ranks. At some point later, you have to pick your specialization, and when you pick your specialization, you have to choose three of these skills. And only those three can go all the way up to the end here. All the others will be capped, you know, here at the midway point. So, ultimately, you have to choose three skills to specialize in. For me, it'll be stealth, pistols, and martial arts, probably. Yeah, probably so. Okay, so let's keep going. Now we're gonna start the actual game. Fucking Sega ruined this game. It's a plane. Oh, there's the logo of Halbeck Corporation. Here are these jackasses wearing shades. I see people wearing shades on planes during the day. I don't, because that's weird, but... That's an awful big missile to use against a plane like that. Oh, there's apparently a bunch of little missiles. I guess the plane didn't have enough levels of toughness. $227 dead. This motherfucker.
If anyone is to blame for these events, Mr. Thornton, it is you. Alpha Protocol began here, after all.
Let me know if anything is too quiet, if you can't hear. 3 months ago, the Gray Box, location classified. Hey, this is kind of like Planescape Torment. You're waking up on a slab. You don't have a floating skull with you, though.
Where's my gear?
I don't think he says, "Where's my gear?" there if you're not a veteran. There's several dialogue things that are different for being a veteran. So I can walk around in here. I can see that apparently heart rate is 70. Oh, that's good. Start randomly fighting nobody. And you get more moves for your martial arts, the higher you level it up. Pick up a PDA. That seems important. Let's make a save right out the gate. Well, you don't walk like this for very long. You only walk like this in the very beginning for some reason. Because you haven't yet unlocked the ability to jog or run.
Good. You're awake. I wasn't sure how long you'd be under. Those tranquilizers wore off fast.
Are hallucinations a side effect, or...
What?
Never mind. Just clearing my head.
The dose was pretty strong. I'm surprised you're even able to stand.
I don't think we've met...
Mina. And the static on the screen is interference, not the drugs.
Too bad. Static's a good look for you. So?
Thank you. If flattery is your only weapon, you'll need a gun. And fast.
Well, I don't want to wear out my welcome. All the more reason to leave.
And how do you propose to do that? You're locked in. There's a guard outside. Eventually he's going to come check on you. And when he does...
I'll think of something. Let me check the room. There's got to be another way out.
All right, then. Don't take too long. The door's locked down. But you might be able to find a way to break the glass.
Alright, so as you can see, the dialogues in this are timed. And you don't pick exactly what your character's gonna say, you just choose a stance, a demeanor. And sometimes you'll get extra choices beyond the three basic demeanors, and sometimes the choices will be different based on things you've done, or, you know, other options. Like, you might know something that other people might not know and get a special option because of that, or whatever, whatever. And sometimes you get options to take direct actions during the cutscenes instead of talking too. But it's timed so that you have a sense of urgency of having to decide quickly what your character is going to do, which is kind of cool. As you go in here, I don't think I have anything in my inventory. I just have hospital scrubs. Aren't the best. They have 5 points of sound dampening, apparently. Neither comfortable nor practical, this is all you had on when you first awoke in the gray box. Civilian clothes are quiet and unassuming, but lack the protection of proper armor. You can totally mod out your weapons and everything, as we're very used to from lots of games by now. Although this was the first game I ever played that I remember being able to do this kind of stuff. And you have mod slots for your armor too, and putting more points into technical aptitude gets you more mod slots for your armor and weapons and stuff like that as well. Then you have your gadgets. I don't have any, but you unlock more slots for extra gadgets with more points in technical aptitude as well. And there's a ton of different gadgets you can get through the game. As you go through the game talking to people and discovering things, you find intel. This is the map we have of this place. I don't know why we have a map of this place since we just woke up here randomly, but sounds good. Find out who's responsible for drugging you and bringing you here. And as you can see, there's a little bit of a... But you buy intel before missions, and you don't have to. It's optional. And the more intel you buy, the more stuff you find out. So if this was a regular mission and I had bought intel ahead of time, there might be stuff marked on this map. There might be secret entrances or passageways available to me that were not available if you don't buy the intel, and that sort of thing. So that's pretty cool. Gives you another thing to spend money on besides just guns and stuff. There was stamps like Democrat or Republicow. That's right, Knox. Does it only answer when it runs out? It only answers when it runs out because I think you can skip the person talking, but the person talking before you is timed so that it ends just as the other thing ends. You know what I mean? But I'm pretty sure you can just skip past it if you want, yeah. So as I go through here, I'll unlock dossiers, which of course I'm going to read every single dossier. There's lots of factions. I haven't found any factions yet. And then there's individuals. I'm 2% on individuals. As you go through, you learn more about each one of these characters. And so the dossiers get more and more expanded. Right now, we just know a little bit about Mina Tang. Now, I don't know why we know this, considering that we just talked to her on a PDA and we have no idea who she is. Did I stop and pull out my phone and, like, Google her? I don't know. But you unlock dossier information as you go, anyway. And you can also unlock secret dossier information by buying intel, or just by learning things by talking to people and choosing the right options in conversations, you can find secret things out about them. And here's the cool thing. The more dossier completion you have on a character, you do more damage against them in combat. So if you end up fighting that person, you do more damage. So that's really helpful for the bosses, because they're pretty hard. And if you find secret dossier information about a character, sometimes you can use it in conversation against them. You can bring it up, like a special option. And a lot of times that will lead to different, more interesting results. So trying to unlock the dossier information for the characters is actually meaningful. It's not just random information. You can actually use this information in the game, which is pretty cool. So Mina Tang, she's... Oh, and of course you have a reputation with each and every character and faction that goes up or down. And you gain advantages based on those reputations, whether they're high or low, which is an idea that you saw in Tyranny, but they also did that way back in this game. So if somebody hates you, you can gain an advantage from that. It doesn't just have to be good reputation. So you can go through the game and make everybody hate you. You can go through the game and make everybody like you. Maybe not absolutely everybody hates you or absolutely everybody like you, but pretty close. 27, she's American, she's an intelligence analyst at Alpha Protocol. Kind of a spoiler. Like, I'm not supposed to know what Alpha Protocol is at this point. Mina Tang is an analyst first, a tactician second, and a field agent third. She's been with Alpha Protocol for about a year, working primarily in encrypting and decrypting information. She assists Alan Parker on intel assignments, but is also called upon to help train new recruits in firearm basics. Her data analysis led to the discovery of several missing advanced prototype missiles from Halbeck's stock, and the evidence she obtained forms the basis for Desert Spear, the mission to track down and deal with Sheikh Ali Shahid. Alright, so that's our very first NPC person. And then you go in here, you can spend your points as you get them. And I've already earned a perk. Now, I love the way the perks are in this game. I'm sure this has been done in other games as well, but basically the way it works is this. As you go through the game, you just earn perks based on what you do. And there are fuck tons of them, and they enhance the things that you're already doing. So, I mean, this just gives you a reduced cooldown on all abilities. It's just, you would get a different perk here if I had chosen different things. But you get perks for doing the same thing over and over. So if I choose a whole lot of suave options, I'll get another suave perk, and then another one, and another one that'll do different things. Or if I choose a whole different range of things, I'll get different perks for choosing a whole different range of things. If I do a lot of stealth stuff, I'll get a bunch of perks related to stealth. If I do a lot of lethal stuff, I'll get a lot of perks related to killing people. If I do a lot of... You know, whatever you do, your playstyle determines what perks you get. It's impossible to get all the perks because you know, there's only so many opportunities to do stuff. So getting through a mission with completely undetected, you might get a perk for that. Or doing that 3 times or 5 times, you might get even better perks that enhance your stealth abilities. Versus if you just cap people in the head a whole bunch with a fucking assault rifle, you'll get perks that allow you to do extra damage on headshots with the assault rifle or whatever. So it's pretty cool. Whatever playstyle you choose, it's rewarded with these little extra abilities and stuff. So that's kind of cool. So far I have one perk, but you get lots of perks through the game. And then it gives you your stats. Pistol accuracy 0%. I played through this my 4th time with 100% pistol accuracy for the entire game. I never missed a shot because every time I missed a shot, I reloaded the checkpoint and played it again. That took a long time. All right, anyway. I might as well look at my abilities real quick. What do I actually have? I have basic concealment. Reduces the range at which enemies can spot you while moving in cover or in a crouched position. Cameras and enemies alerted to your presence are not affected by this vision reduction. So, that just helps me be stealthier at a little bit shorter range. You were asking earlier, Sida, what these arrows meant. The arrows are where you get an active ability, an actual thing you can use. The other ones are all just passive things. What if you cap everyone in the head and remain undetected? Well then, yeah, you'll get perks for both things. Or perhaps a special perk for doing exactly that. There's a lot of perks. And some of them are very hard to get. Like, for you to play this as your perfectionist, you know, completionist thing, you'd have to play through it a few times to get all the perks, because you couldn't get them all in one playthrough. Like, if there's a perk for choosing 200... aggressive dialogue options, you simply couldn't get the 200 aggressive dialogue options perk and the 200 suave dialogue options perk in one game or whatever. I mean, I just made those numbers up, but there's a lot of things that end up being mutually exclusive simply because there's not enough opportunities to get them all. Awareness is really good. Now, this is what I was going to show you guys. If you look... You see that mark right there that's moving across that little arrow thing? That is a guard. And I can see where he is through the wall because of my awareness skill. If I didn't have awareness, I wouldn't see that. So that's like improving your stealth really helps you do stuff. Actually, it's only because I have master awareness. At basic awareness, it's a skill that you have to use, and it gives you the sense of the little markers for 60 seconds, and then you can't use it for a while. But then here at rank 5, it comes master level, and it's always in a full state of alertness. So now I'll always be able to see where enemies are in my immediate area, which makes it much easier to sneak around them and stuff and ambush them. Silent running is nice, makes all walking and running completely silent during the duration of the ability. So, I can turn that on, it's an active skill, and for 10 seconds I can run at full speed without anybody hearing me. Evasion is nice. This is a thing that automatically activates. It's a panic button for sneaking. If an enemy is about to spot you, evasion will activate on its own accord and give you a brief moment of invisibility. Lasts for 2 seconds is all. So, It's just a holy shit, I got spotted. It's a you know, get out of jail free card once every 5 minutes. Gives you that 2 seconds that you need to duck back into hiding and not get spotted. Evasion is good. And then there's better versions of evasion later on, you know, that last longer or can be used more often or something. And then Master Awareness is really good. This is one of the first things... You should pretty much get Master Awareness on every character, no matter what you're doing, because it's just that useful. Knowing where the enemies are all the time is just so good. Then we go into Pistols. This just straight up gives me more accuracy and stability when using Pistols. Pistol can be carefully aimed at a target to score a critical hit. So, you'll see when I start shooting people, you get a reticle that sort of... starts off really spread out, and then as you keep your gun aimed at somebody, the reticle slowly comes down and becomes smaller and smaller and smaller until it reaches its smallest size. If you shoot somebody when the reticle is at that smallest size, you'll get a critical hit. But it's kind of hard to do in the beginning of the game, at least, because it takes a long time for the reticle to shrink that much, and you have to keep the aim on them. So if you want to shoot them in the head, you've got to keep your reticle over their head for a long time, even as they move around and stuff, and then take the shot at the right moment. Improving your pistol skill simply reduces the amount of time it takes for that reticle to shrink. So that eventually you can start lining up those critical headshots really quickly and just acing people, and it's fucking awesome. See, right now it'll take 2.5 seconds to aim a critical hit on somebody. Oh yeah, and the range improves as well. Right now it's 15 meters, but eventually you'll be able to crit people in the head with a pistol from pretty far away. Will you be singing when you get critical hits? I don't think I can sing for all the critical hits I'll be getting in this. Chain shot, the most overpowered thing for killing bosses. Now, this is only the basic level of chain shot, but when you get master chain shot, it's friggin' ridiculous. So chain shot basically freezes time. It says slows time down to a crawl, but it really means a crawl. You pretty much freeze time. And during that time, you can aim and fire off multiple shots. And then when time goes back to normal, all those shots go off at once. So it makes it super easy to line up multiple headshots on multiple enemies, or to line up a bunch of headshots on one tough enemy, like a boss. So at the basic level, it's only 2 shots, right? But at the max level, it's like 6 shots or something. It's friggin' ridiculous. You just hit chain shot, you instantly get 6 fucking headshots on a dude. It's ridiculous. It's really good. That's why pistols are the most overpowered weapon, because the special abilities for the other weapons simply are not as good as chain shot. Not even close. Redemption mode in RDR then? Yeah, I haven't played that, but I've heard it's really good. But it's got a cooldown. You can't just use chain shot all the damn time. But it's super helpful. Armed and dangerous, you can carry twice your normal amount of pistol ammunition. At this level of competence, you can line up a critical hit while hiding in cover. I cannot tell you how good that is. You'll see how cool it is when I start using it, but what you won't see is what it's like not to have that. Because without this, and again, this is if you're using any other kind of gun besides a pistol, or if you're suck at using a pistol and don't have this yet, you've got to lean out of cover to do this aiming to line up the critical shot, which means they can see you. So while you're sitting there hoping nobody looks at you while you're lining up the shot for 2.5 seconds, right? Whereas with this, you can line that thing up while still being completely hidden in cover. And then you just take the shot and your guy just kind of pokes the gun out from behind the cover, shoots the dude in the head, and nobody even sees you because you never even left cover. It's freaking amazing. It's amazing. That's why pistols are the best. And then at this point also, the range is 20 meters, which is nice. So that will continue to improve, you know. All this stuff continues to improve. Then you get things like rapid reload, blah, blah, blah. And all this stuff gets better as you go. Why do I have 2 in shotguns? Did I fuck up my character? I did fuck up my character. I don't want 2 in shotguns. Hold on a second. I screwed up. I gotta fix this real quick. Hard. Veteran. Get out of here, shotguns. Get out of here, submachine guns. Submachine guns suck. They're the worst weapon in the game. Shotguns are okay, and assault rifles are okay. But they don't do anything super cool like pistols do. Oh, and now I have a little more toughness this time and 3 points left over. That's good. Already restarting, that's right. But I'm gonna skip everything this time. Am I gonna skip everything? Pretty sure I can skip this. I mean, I literally haven't left the first room, so it's not like I'm losing progress. Skip. Skip. Oh, there we go. I can fast forward past stuff by pressing E. Okay. What's up with the... Yeah, there we go.
Good. You're awake. What?
Ugh.
The dose was pretty strong. I'm surprised you're even able to stand.
I know. Too bad.
Thank you.
Well, I don't want...
I'll improvise. Of course we'll be in this room for an hour. Have you ever watched me play a game before?
But you might be able to find a way to break the glass.
Alright. Back to where we were. Let's make sure I look at all this stuff. Yeah, Mina Tang, fine. Anyway, back to my skills, which are now properly assigned. Then there's sabotage. The first thing you get is interference. You tune EMP charges to temporarily disable electronic keypads and computer systems without utterly destroying them, letting them take control of security systems with ease. This just lets you use a gadget to bypass a lock or something instead of having to do the mini game. I very rarely do this. Unless the stakes are high, because sometimes there'll be a really hard minigame and it'll automatically set off an alarm in the whole building if you fail it once. And so on those, and you might have to go back to a long-ass checkpoint to do it again. So if it's like a super high stakes one where I'm likely to fuck it up and set off an alarm and ruin my whole stealth, then I might use a EMP charge. But other than that, I don't use them. Breaking and entering reduces the this just straight up reduces the difficulty of the mini games, and this is very important, because as I said earlier, the mini games get stupid hard if you don't have some levels of breaking and entering. Overclock enhances the effect of the next offensive gadget use, changes the effect radius, stun or damage. I basically never use this. I don't know if I've ever really used overclock, maybe a couple of times. Shape charge. Proper ordnance handling allows you to rig gadgets with directional blasts, preventing embarrassing and potentially fatal accidents from poorly placed devices. This is pretty good. Renders you immune to all damage from your own gadgets. This is pretty good. Somehow you magically become immune to your own grenades and shit, so you don't blow yourself up. Or you can set mines, you can set traps, and then, you know, they can run over and trigger them and you can be standing right there and it doesn't hit you. That's pretty good. Improve data theft. Increases the value of stolen files on a successful hack. Yes! Extra cash bonus on hacking. Very good. Because you do a lot of hacking for cash in this game. I mean, it's optional, but of course you're going to do it, right? Technical aptitude. Improves the efficacy of Mike's healing. Plus 50% from first aid kits. I don't end up using very many first aid kits in my playstyle. Weaponry chambering automatically customizes all of Mike's weapons to store additional rounds in the chamber, allowing all of his weapons to store a few extra rounds above and beyond any rounds granted from magazine modifications. So, a few extra bullets in my pistol, that's nice. Field stripping. A trained agent can quickly strip ammunition out of a gun's chamber or magazine. Field stripping increases the amount of ammunition looted off of enemies or found in caches. You find more ammo, that's nice. Not really necessary, though, because there's always plenty of ammo. If you're doing a pistol build. If you're playing right, and playing right means killing people with one shot or two tops with critical hit headshots. If you're just spraying bullets all over the place, then you might not have enough ammo. This ability reduces the cooldown on using first aid supplies, okay. Cooldown reduced, that's alright, I guess. Like I said, technical aptitude is not really necessary. Nothing you get in technical aptitude is so good, although brilliance is actually a really good ability. It resets all your other cooldowns. But these are all nice little things, but they're not really necessary. And with weapon balancing, Mike can meticulously adjust his firearms for the ideal recoil to weight ratio. Improves recoil on every weapon. That's kind of cool. Alright, then there's toughness. Pretty simple. Gives you some extra health. Gives you some more extra health. Resilience decreases the delay before Mike starts to recover endurance. I think endurance is like your armor, and then you have your actual health. I don't remember exactly how endurance works. We'll figure it out. And then there's martial arts. It's really fun to beat people up with martial arts in this. Close-quarter combat proficiency increases the damage inflicted with all hand-to-hand attacks, so it goes up pretty significantly. Strike combo extends the number of quick strikes Mike can chain together by quickly pressing left click. Basic level, basic three-strike combo becomes four strikes. Melee defense basic reduces the damage received from enemy hand-to-hand attacks. Knockback strike is a slower but more powerful version of Mike's standard close-quarter combat attack. A successful knockback strike will stagger your victim and push them out of your personal space. Get out of my personal space, man! Left-click, hold it to use this move. Okay, I'll try to remember that. Oh, and then Fury. This is when you want to melee a boss or some tough-ass dudes. Sends you into an adrenaline rush, increases hand-to-hand damage, reduces the effectiveness of enemy blocking attempts, and slows down the world for a brief period of time. You can't be in stealth. Any aiming, shooting, or throwing ends. This is when you basically Hulk rage out and just start beating ass. And basic Fury doesn't do that much, but like the Master Fury pretty much turns you into an ultimate killing machine. Alright, good. That's what our abilities do. We've gone through everything. We are now ready to leave the first room. I need to find out who has captured me, why I'm captive in this weird place, get some better clothes. Now I can sprint. Oh, a sprint button. That seems like something every game should have, right? I can throw the extinguisher to break the glass. That's what we're doing with improvising. That's not very stealthy.
In case of emergency.
That did it.
Guess Sleeping Beauty's had enough. That you, Mike? You just hold on. I'm sending some guards to tuck you back in.
I guess he sees me. Well, come on in here, boys. I don't think I chose a very wise option. It's not very sneaky. I don't think they're gonna come at me. Ow. Alright, so I lost a little bit of health there, but you saw before I lost my health, I lost my endurance, which is not very much because I'm not wearing armor. Are these guys ever gonna come at me? Apparently not. See, I have 30 points of oh, here they come.
Someone there.
I think if I wait long enough, they'll get confused and, like, go off of alert status and just assume I'm gone. Which is always hilarious. Must have been the wind. Ow, motherfucker. Okay, you know what? We're done playing. Now you might be asking yourself, did Josiah just get killed in the first room of the game? You might be asking yourself that. The answer is, yes. I did just get killed in the first room of the game. Alright, that improvise option was terrible. I don't know why I picked that. Well, I told you I put it on hard, right? And these enemies start out... Okay, that's not good. That's no bueno. Hold on a second, we're starting over again. We're starting over. This goes very differently if you choose a different option there. Wait, no. I do want pistols. I don't want submachines. We're starting over one more time. Best Alpha Protocol stream ever. I've been streaming for an hour. We're now on our third restart. And have not left the first room. Well, it is on hard. What do you want from me? Improvise is basically like astrology, yeah. And that was as a veteran. Imagine how much my ass would have just gotten shot off if I was just one of the normal starting scrub.
Where's my
Saito level of perfection when playing a game. That's right. I come over here, I check out the door. Oh no, I can't get out the door. What will I do? Let's check out this PDA.
Good. You're awake. What?
You don't get that hallucination if you're not playing on veteran.
Clearing my head.
The dose is pretty strong. I'm surprised you're even able to stand.
They could have just replaced improvise with YOLO.
Mina.
Too bad.
Yeah, improvise was a terrible idea.
Well, I don't...
Ambush is better.
Why wait? Set off an alarm, let him know I'm awake.
What? That'll bring him running.
Saves me the trouble of hunting him down.
Activating the alarm now. Hope you know what you're doing.
Oh, I know what I'm doing.
Guess Sleeping Beauty's had enough. That you, Mike? You just hold on. I'm sending some guards to tuck you back in.
So this dude knows
you
my
said
name.
One guard.
Looks like he's brought the rest of his squad. A veteran like you should be able to handle it.
See? This is different. I knew it. This is different because you're a veteran. Normally there is only one guard. That's pretty cool. That's why she said a veteran like you should be able to handle it. Well, come on through the door, kids. They'll come in here eventually.
Someone there?
Ignore. You pretend they don't exist or something? That's a little fucking better. Alright, so some mysterious dudes with guns just ran in here. Trying to take me out. I took them out, ninja style, and I'm about to do an amazing thing. I'm about to leave the first room, guys. Left click to break open the door, or you can just open the door. Break open the door is nice if there's somebody standing on the other side of it. You can, like, knock their ass down or stun them or something by kicking the door into their face. Opening the door is more quiet. Something very strange about this elevator. Where is this strange facility that I'm in? Who knows? I guess we'll find out in our next episode. It's gonna do it for this one. So if you're watching the stream, do not go anywhere because I'm not done playing. If you're watching on YouTube, that's gonna do it for this episode. So thank you for watching. This has been Josiah Plays Alpha Protocol.